He has been called a lot of things over the course of his long, colorful life. A surprise baby by his then 42-year-old mother, an artistic prodigy by his earliest teachers, a scene stealer by those who shared the stage with him, a fine marksman by his drill sergeant in basic training for World War II, a brave soldier by the officer awarding him the Purple Heart, a soulmate by Nicole, his true love and wife of 47 years. That American artist by an unconvinced French father-in-law. A quick study by his famous European art instructors. An inspiring teacher by legions of university art students. An easy read by those who have discovered his novels and poetry. The Man with the Junk in the Yard by city officials. A Lifetime Achievement Award winner by the governor. But me, I just call him Pops. Many of a certain age can only find their past in clouded memories and boxes of faded 3x5 Instamatic snapshots. Of course, I have those too. But I'm also very fortunate to find mine in the timelessness of vivid watercolors, pastels, and oils, recorded by the deft strokes of an American master. I want to introduce to you a true Arkansas man of distinction, Gene Hatfield. Of course, I would think so regardless. I'm his only daughter, Matilda. And let me tell you, for me and my brothers, Hadrian and Mark, growing up with Pops was quite a colorful journey. After all, how many Arkansas kids spent nearly every summer in the north of France? For us, it was all fun, playing with cousins, seeing the bright lights of Paris, and trips to the beach. But Pops, he was at work. From 1960 to the mid-70s, he trained with some of the greatest artists of the day in some of the most prestigious studios in Europe.
Nicole's father happened to know a Mr. Goetz, a friend of Picasso's who had worked with him, helping to get artists out of France during the war. And he is a well-known French painter who had schools both in Paris and Fontainebleau, and I went to school both places with him. The method of teaching in France is quite different from here in the United States in that you go into the workshop and set up your easel and you get out your paints and they furnish a nude model and you paint bodies and you do not have any class discussions at all. It's you and the teacher and learning the techniques that the teacher expects you to acquire. The class in Aix-en-Provence was entirely different. It was there that I went to study more about Cézanne and Cubism. I got a lot of good first-hand experience painting the places that Cézanne had painted and learning more about him. But I profited from painting his home and his studio. I got to paint inside his studio and where he was born and where he died and the shoe shop that was his daddy's. That's one of my favorite paintings, and I did at least two, one in oil and one in pastel. In St. Ives, the light there is in Western England is very, very special. And I must say that my paintings looked better, my watercolors and oils too, but they took on a special quality because of the light that shone on the figures or the buildings. Mr. Fuller was the teacher in England, and his favorite word was beautiful, so I satisfied him at least and did some of my best work, I think. I feel that I profited highly from the contrast and from the difference in atmosphere in students and teachers.
An actor, a painter, a sculptor, a teacher, an author, a poet, a singer, a dancer, you name it. My Pops has done it. One dictionary definition of a Renaissance man is a present-day man who has acquired profound knowledge or proficiency in more than one field. Of course, he would never call himself any such thing. Just like with art, he would prefer us to decide for ourselves.